Last week, we saw that perfect consistency doesn't exist in a Pokemon run. So today, with the help of our first channel member, Mark McCarty, we're gonna dive in a little bit deeper to see how much a specific win rate affects our run, particularly the level that we finish at. And in order to do that, Mark McCarty requested that we take a run with a Chansey, which, talking about chance and win rates, the Chansey's perfect. So Professor Oak catches us a Chansey, and we're going to name our Chansey Tank, because that was what was requested by Mark McCarty. But this Chansey is going to be doing three runs through the entire game. One run where it needs to win one time out of five attempts. One time where it's going to have to win three of five attempts against each trainer. And finally, a run where it has to win five of five against all 65 required trainers in the game. This is crazy. So we're going to start off with the 1 of 5 run, where we're going to go straight to fight Rival 1. Basically, we're just going to use a couple of Tail Whips and then go into Pound. Easy game. Getting 1 of 5 in the Rival fight is really no challenge at all. So now let's move on to Viridian Forest. And in Viridian Forest, we should be able to take out this Bug Catcher without too much trouble, I think. So let's just try it. We're going to start off by setting up a couple Tail Whips because we are very underleveled relative to it. And then we're going to go into Pound. We can see that it does a lot of damage to us. So that's okay. We have five attempts to knock this thing out. We're just going to set up our Tail Whips, go into Pound, and this one goes much better. So there we go. We have taken out that Bug Catcher. So with that Bug Catcher done, it's time to take on Brock. And we're going to try to set up some Tail Whips and go into Pound, but we're 3-hit KO. Chansey has no shot of beating Brock on minimal battles, so we're going to have to level up. Well, this is where we're going to do just like we did in the perfectly consistent run last week. We're going to level up with Rare Candies. And the reason is because we're doing three runs, we want to keep our stat experience constant. We don't want to allow stat experience to skew our data one way or the other. So we're going to start leveling up here and see what level we finally become able to win a fight against Brock with this Chansey. And this is not trivial, because we have a type disadvantage and we have probably the lowest defense of any Pokemon in the game. And his Geodude's only going to use Tackle every single turn. So all of those factors together mean that Chansey is a really great example here of a Pokemon that struggles so hard against Brock. It's going to have to level up so much that you might think, well, when we become capable of winning 1 out of 5 against Brock, we're probably not that far from being able to win 5 of 5 against Brock. Because winning 1 of 5 against Brock is basically going to mean that we're overleveled so much that we're just able to batter his Pokemon down with Pound. So here we're just trying to see what level we're finally going to get a proper attempt at, because we've got to try 5 times every time, and if we lose, we lose. If we win, we win. Well, right here at level 23, we have picked up the move Double Slap, so we use some Tail Whips. Now we go into Double Slap. Double Slap can hit up to 5 times, so if we get good ranges on it, we may be able to get through this fight. We are definitely getting ahead on the Geodude. There we go. We've got 40 HP remaining for Onix. It uses Bide, so we get to set up our Tail Whips. We are outspeeding at this point. He uses Bide again. So now we get to finish setting up our Tail Whips, and we're going to use Double Slap. And we've run out of PP on that, so now let's go into Pound. Pound is doing decent damage, but we get taken out. Okay, so let's try this again. We're going to set up our Tail Whips. Now let's go into Double Slap. And Double Slap is doing decent damage again here against the Geodude. We're only 13 levels higher than it, but hey, it's looking like we're getting through again on 40 HP remaining. This is getting to be pretty consistent. And he uses Bide, perfect. We get to set up some Tail Whips. He uses Bide again. Let's set up more Tail Whips. And now we're going to use Double Slap. And we're just hoping for good ranges. He uses Bite again, so we'll just waste the turns. Now Pound. We've got 30 HP remaining, 19 HP remaining. He uses Bide, but now we get through. So here at level 23, we can beat Brock in a 1-of-5 situation. But that doesn't look very consistent. Clearly 5-of-5 doesn't work there. We're going to have to level up more. But hey, a win is a win. So with that being done, we can now start making our way through the rest of the required trainers in the game. And it's important to note here, we've just picked up the Bide TM, but there are actually a bunch of TMs that we're going to ban in this run. We are going to ban moves like Bide, Mimic, Rest, Double Team, Substitute, any TM that is learnable by all Pokemon. Why? Well, when we talk about consistency runs, every run would devolve into just spamming Substitute, Double Team, Toxic, maybe Mimic, every single time. If we were trying to do perfectly consistent runs with anything goes. And the reason is because we've already shown on this channel that we can take a level 5 Gyarados, a level 5 Ghastly, and crush the entire Elite Four. With a level 5 Gyarados, we were able to crush the entire game of Pokemon Red and Blue. And it all comes down to those moves. But it's not as simple as just banning Double Team. You have to ban a lot more than that in order to make it a consistent rule set. So we've just picked up the Bide TM, but we're never going to use it. And that's going to be the same when we pick up Toxic from Koga, for example. We're never going to use that move. And when we, if we get into a tough spot later, if you guys are saying, well, why don't you just use Substitute? No, Substitute is banned because every Pokemon can use it. If you're going to make the meta centralizing argument against using certain TMs like Double Team, well, you got to be consistent. It has to be every TM that is meta centralizing. So, just so you know, those TMs are banned. We're not using them. And at this point, we don't need them. We're crushing everything. We've learned Water Gun. Water Gun is so much stronger here on a Chansey with this ridiculous special stat than using Mega Punch, even though Mega Punch is stab, because we've only got 8 attack. So here, Water Gun allows us to completely wreck the Super Nerd. We're going to pick up the Helix Fossil because it's in front of us. Like, why does it matter? And we're going to take down Team Rocket. We're just going to go straight for Water Gun. 2 Water Guns for each of their Pokemon, and it's really not hard. We take them out. Let's move on to Cerulean. The junior trainer here is not too bad. We've got access to Tail Whip and Sing at this point, and we just use Mega Punch to take her down. Let's go to Misty, where Misty is going to potentially present a problem. Water Gun is our strongest move, but it's going to be resisted by her. But we do have access again to Tail Whip and Sing, and those are the key. Because Sing is only 55% accurate, but if we can get Sing to stick, then we can set up some Tail Whips, and our Mega Punch will actually get to the point where it does decent damage. It's a 2-hit KO on Staryu after setting up the Tail Whips. Now let's Sing on Starmie, and we're going to set up some Tail Whips, go into Mega Punch. She can use X Defend, she can use Harden when she wakes up, but we get through. So Chansey has gotten through the first 2 gyms, but that's with the rules being that we just have to win 1 out of 5 times. Let's take on Rival 2 instead now, but we have a huge advantage. We've just picked up Bubble Beam. Bubble Beam one-shots Spearow, one-shots Sandshrew, one-shots Rattata. It's a 2-shot on Eevee. But we can already see that that one would be incredibly consistent. And everything going north to Bill's house with Bubble Beam is pretty darn consistent too. There are only a couple of Pokemon in this entire section that are not one-hit KOs, and they're basically the Oddishes on the last Lass. So we crushed that entire section. We're going to save Bill, and now we're going to make our way down to the SS Anne. And this is one of those things where we can see that even at this level, everything's basically one shot. So let's go to Rival 3. Here, we one-shot Spearow. We have a chance to learn Growl, which we're not going to mess with. It's not worth it. We're going to one-shot Rattata, one-shot Sandshrew, and hey, again, it's two shots on Eevee. This is ridiculous, guys. Like, after we get that move, we're basically just crushing everything. Now we can go fight Lieutenant Surge, where our best strategy will be to try to put him to sleep and use Bubble Beam. If we take a couple Mega Kicks, we'll probably get taken out, but if he just uses Thunderbolt, our huge special stat means that we'll probably be just fine. So I'm just healing up really quick here, and let's get into the fight. So in this one, we're going to try to sing to put him to sleep. We missed the first time, we missed the second time, and we get taken out. So, Sing has only 55% accuracy. We expected that. Try number two, we put him to sleep. We use Bubble Beam. He hits us with a Thunderbolt and a Growl, but it doesn't matter. We take him out. So there we go. Chansey has three badges. We've had, other than Brock, not really any difficulty getting through. But now let's try the Rapping Lass on the way to Cerule, or on the way to Celadon, because she presents her own issues. We can already see that maybe from a consistency standpoint, this could be difficult. All of these Pokemon are two-hit KOs, but they all know status moves. Sleep Powder, Poison Powder, Stun Spore. Any of those could potentially derail an otherwise winning run. And the only way that we're going to get through those later on is probably going to be with Sing, which is only 55% accurate. So we are going to have potentially some trouble there. Now moving on to the Bug Catcher. He's no challenge at all. We just completely wreck him. And really, with this current moveset that we have, where we've got Bubble Beam right now, we're just about to add Thunderbolt here. Like, what is going to really stand in our way? And we're going to dive into these battles a little bit more here, so that when we come back with the 5 of 5 run, we don't necessarily need to see them all. When we come up against Pokemon like Slowpoke, we've got Thunderbolt. When we come up against Cubone, we've got Bubble Beam. When we come up against the Self-Destruct Hiker, we've got Bubble Beam. So really, the only trainer that presents any sort of trouble in this entire section is the status junior trainer, basically. Here with an Oddish and a Bulbasaur, yes, she can status us because it's not a one-hit KO. It's a three-hit KO with Thunderbolt on her Oddish and takes a couple of Thunderbolts to take down the Bulbasaur. But the Self-Destruct Hiker, piece of cake. One Bubble Beam wrecks all of his Pokemon. And the last trainer, again, really not a big issue because she's going to lead off with Meowth. We're just going to use Thunderbolt. We're going to use Thunderbolt a couple of times on the Oddish here, and a Thunderbolt on the Pidgey. Done. So now we can take on Rival 4, and Rival 4 is another completely easy battle. We're just completely wrecking everything. Thunderbolt for everything that is weak to Thunder. We're two Thunderbolts on the Eevee. There we go. That's easy. That's clearly consistent. We don't even need to play it five times, right? Here, we make our way all the way to Celadon, and now we can pick up Ice Beam. And with Ice Beam, we're yet again going to be in a great spot. We're just going to replace Bubble Beam with Ice Beam immediately, and we can just go fight Erica, I think. Because Erica is a grass-type trainer, Ice Beam will be super effective on her Pokemon. I'm thinking that this is going to be pretty good, but we're also going to pick up another useful TM. We're going to get the Psychic TM here. We're definitely going to need Psychic late in the game for Agatha, but it could come into play against Koga or Giovanni. It just depends on how the ranges go. Here against the Beauty, we just use one Ice Beam and take it out. We've got such a massive special stat, it's ridiculous. So let's just try this against Erica. Here, we are slower than the Tangela, but it takes two Ice Beams to take it down. It takes two Ice Beams to take out Weepinbell and two Ice Beams to take out Gloom. We get paralyzed, but that wasn't really that hard. So we just get through that section and we can move on to the Rocket game corner. All of these Team Rocket members are complete cakewalks. I mean, it's one Ice Beam or one Thunderbolt to take out the two Pokemon on the poster grunt. It's going to be the same thing for the Lift Key grunt. They just can't stand up to our massive special stat. Jesse and James, hey, we're just going to spam Ice Beam. And none of these Pokemon can do anything. Oh, Thunderbolt on Ekans. Oops. And let's go fight Giovanni now where, hey, we're just going to use Bubble Beam and take out these Pokemon. And hey, we can just use a two-hit KO on the Persian. So we're not struggling at all. And the Chandlers and the Pokemon Tower, again, we've got all special type moves. We've got a massive HP stat. Even if we start hitting ourselves in confusion, we've got huge HP and very low attack. So we're going to survive a lot of hits in confusion. And we can just make our way through the Pokemon Tower without really too much difficulty. I'm only picking up items here in case we needed Hyper Beam later in the game. Substitute, remember, is banned because it's meta centralizing. So we are going to just save those items in case we need Hyper Beam for some reason later in the game, but it's probably not very relevant with our low attack stat. So here we are fighting the Ghost Marowak where, hey, one Ice Beam, done. And we can get to Jesse and James where it's just going to be more of the same, really. And we have the chance right now to learn Minimize. And I decide to learn Minimize over Bubble Beam. Now you might be saying, what are you, Double Team's banned, why are you using Minimize? In these runs, we're always going to use the Pokemon's level up learn set. I'm sorry, but I'm not here to ban things that were specifically designed into a Pokemon. I'm fine with banning TMs on the meta centralizing argument, but banning Sing because if they learn a sleep move, that could be completely broken. I mean, come on. So we're allowing Minimize for this one. It's going to be the same for all of them. We're comparing apples to apples, folks. So here, let's take on Rival 5. And we are going to start by using some Minimize and Sing. And the strategy here, of course, is to lower the opponent's accuracy. But guess what? Sand Slash knows Swift. Does this make, like, do accuracy strats make this completely consistent? No, the champion always carries Swift on his team. So here we're going to try to set it up again. We need the Sand Slash to stay asleep long enough that we're able to get our setup off. We one-shot it with a Ice Beam. Now we Thunderbolt down the Cloyster. We managed to get a freeze on Magneton, which makes this a guaranteed win. Now we're going for Thunderbolt on Kadabra. Takes a few hits, but we take it down. And finally, the Flareon. We're just trying to get the luck. We've taken a couple of accuracy drops ourselves, but we paralyzed it. Perfect. And we've run out of PP. So this is the effect of accuracy strats. And just because we have Minimized setup doesn't prevent our opponent from hitting us 1 in 4 times with sand attack. And we've taken multiple sand attacks. So we've run out of PP. Now we have to hope that we can survive with enough HP remaining to actually struggle this Flareon down. We finally do. We beat it with struggle. Oh, that's stupid. Jesse and James are completely easy because we don't even really need to mess with Sing. I used Sing here and I set up a Minimize, but really you can just go all in on just attacking them. They're all 2-hit KOs, except for Meowth, which is a 1-hit KO. So after healing up, we come back, we're ready to go to Giovanni, and his Nidorino knows Double Kick. So we want to put it to sleep, we absolutely want to set up a few Minimizes here, it's the best strategy, and then we're going to go ahead and use Thunderbolt in order to take this thing down. And now against Persian, a couple of Thunderbolts and an Ice Beam on the Rhyhorn. And this is the reason why we needed Minimize. We got taken out by Nidoqueen using Double Kick. So let's try this one a second attempt. We're all the way down to 7 HP and we get knocked out. Let's try this a third attempt. Here, Double Kick is super strong. And we managed to go ahead and take out the Nidorino and we get a bite from the Persian. That's 3 losses in a row. Now let's try this one here. We are putting the Nidorino to sleep. We are setting up our Minimize, and we clearly need it for the rest of the team. We have no defense. We take down the Nidorino. We take a hit from Persian, but we manage to knock it out, take out Rhyhorn, and it's two hits to take out the Nidoqueen. We don't get it. We get knocked out. We have to win this one. Otherwise, we're going to have to reroute or level up. Here, we're down to 11 HP already on the first Nidorino. But we managed to get our Minimize set up. We get the Thunderbolts off to take out the first two Pokemon. It's always going to be one Ice Beam to take out the Rhyhorn. And there we go, folks. That's five attempts that we failed. And because we failed five times in a row, we have to reroute or give ourselves a different move. Well, fortunately, we can go down and fight Koga right now. And Koga's gym isn't really too bad because the jugglers are all using Psychic-type Pokemon, but we have a massive special stat. We're losing to Giovanni because of our low defense. So if we can just gain a couple more levels, we may be able to outspeed, we may be able to be in a better damage range. It's clearly possible to beat Giovanni at that point. It's simply not consistent enough that we could really bank on it because sleep with Sing is just really inaccurate. I mean, it's only 55% accurate. So here we're just making our way through the jugglers in Koga's gym, which, yet again, pretty darn consistent. We don't really need to worry too much as long as we can get sleep on them, but we do have to take into account the fact that they could get special drops with Psychic, they could use Headbutt multiple times, they could poison us. There's a lot of ways that they could beat us still. Let's move on to Koga himself, where the Venonat, the first Venonat only knows Tackle and Psychic, and it could use Sleep Powder on us. But if we put it to sleep and we set up some withdrawals, then we can just go into Ice Beam. It's actually a two-hit KO on each of these Venonats at this point. We got a crit on the first one, but now we get a freeze on the Venomoth. That's a guaranteed win. Hey, we only have to win one of five. That was the first attempt and we took it out. So now let's go back to Giovanni. Let's see if we can beat him at this level. And basically the strategy is pretty much the same. We're going to try to set up Sing. We take a double kick, we take a second double kick, and we're out. So we've got to try this again. We get to Sing on the second attempt. Now we are setting up our Minimize and we put it back to sleep when it wakes up. Finish setting up Minimize. Keep in mind, we have a badge boost in speed now from Koga. So we do outspeed and we are able to take out the first two Pokemon. We're all the way to Nidoqueen. We have a chance to learn Defense Curl. I actually decided against it. Minimize, I think, is the better play. If we weren't allowing Minimize, we'd definitely learn Defense Curl here for the badge boost, but we wouldn't be getting to this point in this fight without Minimize. Absolutely not. So here we are up against the Nidoqueen. We outspeed, we put it to sleep, and then it's two Ice Beams to take it down. So there we go. We have gotten through Giovanni. Now we can go and fight Sabrina. Sabrina is another one that we would expect to not be too hard because we have a massive special stat and she's only going to use special type attacking moves. The problem is the Abra at the very beginning because it will just spam Flash to drop our accuracy. And it doesn't make the battle impossible by any means. We take down the Abra. We want to put Kadabra to sleep because it could use Recover. We really don't want to take a situation where we've done a lot of damage and it uses Recover. We can actually end up running out of PP. Now, on the Alakazam, I'm using Ice Beam. Yes, you could argue that I'm trying to go for the freeze, but actually I end up putting it to sleep because it's just better to have it be asleep for a long time and hopefully get it in a situation where we can get it to not use Recover. We're getting very low on HP, but we do put it back to sleep. We get a Thunderbolt. We just need one more hit on this thing. Can we get the luck? Now I have to use up all of my PP, but we take a Psychic and we get taken out. Let's try this again. Second attempt. Here, we get one accuracy drop, two accuracy drops, but we get Sing off finally on the Abra. We are setting up our minimize, and basically we're just hoping to take out Abra fairly quickly. It's a 3-hit KO though. So here we are going to now go into trying to take out this Kadabra, but we get taken out the second attempt. Third attempt. We just need a lucky one, right? Where we don't take any accuracy drops, or ideally not too many accuracy drops. We put the Abra back to sleep here. We're going to set up our minimize. Just stay asleep, Abra. Okay. And now it's 3-hit KO to take out. And now we are going for Sing into Ice Beam on the Kadabra. It wakes up, but we take it out. And now we are singing and trying to take down this Alakazam. Uses Recover, but now we put it back to sleep. And if we can just get it to stay asleep long enough, there we go. We have beaten Sabrina. But we can see that that one is not very consistent, especially because of the accuracy luck at the beginning with Abra. So we'll keep that in mind when we come back for our 5 of 5. Let's take on Blaine. Blaine, basically, he has really strong physical attacking moves. Stomp with Rapidash, Takedown with Arcanine. Those are what we're really worried about here. We managed to take out the Ninetales. We get a Paralysis on the Rapidash and take it down. Now we are singing to hopefully stop the Arcanine from attacking us. It stays asleep and we take him down. Now we've got a special badge boost on top of our massive special stat, but it's time to take on Giovanni. There are two required trainers in Giovanni's gym. The Rhyhorn trainer doesn't matter, he's a 1-hit KO. We could learn Psychic and make this black belt super, super consistent, but even here without Psychic, he's 2-hit KO on the Machokes and a 1-hit KO on Machop. And now we can just go and fight Giovanni. And basically, the idea against Giovanni is to try to get our minimize set up. So we're going to try to sing on the Dugtrio, set up our minimize, and then Ice Beam for most of his team. So we put the Dugtrio to sleep, we're setting up minimize, and we really just need to take that one down. It's a 1-hit KO on Dugtrio. It's 2 hits on the Persian. We have a chance to learn Light Screen, but I'm not going to. Here, it's going to be 2 hits on Nidoqueen. It's 2 hits on Nidoking. And it's going to be 2 hits on the Rhydon. But we actually run out of PP because we took a Sand Attack from the very first Dugtrio. This is stupid. We're still on full HP, but really, one Earthquake probably takes us down here. And sure enough, it does. So let's try this again, where, again, we have to try to get Sing on the Dugtrio. This time we didn't take an accuracy drop. That is awesome. So now we're going to set up our minimize and try to get through this one. And Earthquake does a ton of damage, but we have a bunch of badge boosts in already. So we one-shot that. It's 2 shots to take down the Persian. We clearly are missing a bunch of times, though. This is terrible. It's the problem with long battles. Here, Nidoqueen takes us out. Double kick on both of the Nidos is an easy KO on us. Let's try attempt number 3. Here we put the Dugtrio to sleep. We are using Minimize over and over and over again. And one Ice Beam takes out the Dugtrio, but a Slash knocks us out from the Persian. Okay, this is getting bad. So we really need the luck to put that Dugtrio to sleep. We're all the way down to 16 HP after a single Earthquake. So we put it to sleep again, now minimize, and Ice Beam to take it down. Thunderbolt, it's 2 Thunderbolts to take down the Persian. We've leveled up, we've lost our badge boosts here, but we put the Nidoqueen to sleep and then take it down. We're going to try to put Nidoking to sleep. There we go. It wakes up immediately though, but we take it out. And now we use Sing to put Rhydon to sleep. It's a 2-hit KO, and we have gotten through on the 5th attempt. So Giovanni's not going to be super consistent, we can already see, but he's possible. Now let's move on to Rival 6, where the strategy, hey, it's the same thing that we've been doing this whole time. Sing on the Sandslash, minimize, and we really just don't want to take Swift. So we want to keep putting this Sandslash to sleep while we do our setup. Then one Ice Beam is enough to take it down. One Ice Beam takes out Execute. One Thunderbolt takes out Cloyster. It's going to be a couple of Ice Beams here to take out Magneton, but we get the freeze. Now on Kadabra, it's just using Reflect. Perfect. We take it down. And finally on the Flareon, we just spam Thunderbolt and we take it out. And there we go. We're all the way to the Elite Four. And it's time to take on Lorelei. Now, I did a test run of this entire run before this one, so I do know a little bit about the ranges here. So we are going to start off by setting up a few minimizes and then using Thunderbolt to take out Dewgong. We put the Cloyster to sleep, and now we want to set up the rest of our minimize here. That's because we leveled up. We lost our badge boosts. So by leveling up and then setting up on the Cloyster, we get better ranges and we're able to take out Lorelei's entire team. So that's one Elite Four member done. And that one is pretty darn consistent. Outside of taking a bunch of takedowns from the Dewgong or getting some really lucky hits, we're gonna get through that one most of the time. Let's move on to Bruno. Bruno could be trouble here. If he hits one high jump kick, we're dead. But basically what we're going to do is try to put this Onix to sleep, now set up our minimize. This is basically like trying to beat Bruno with a level 5 Pokemon, but one Thunderbolt takes out each of the Hitmons. Here, we leveled up, so we're going to put Onix to sleep, set up the rest of our minimize here, and now use Ice Beam, and it's going to take a couple of Ice Beams. It's actually a 3-hit KO. It was a range there on the Machamp. So now let's move on to Agatha, and this is what we've been saving Psychic for this entire time. Because Psychic is going to give us an attacking move that's super effective on all of her Pokemon and make this one really not that bad. Really, think about it. The only Pokemon that use strong physical moves here are going to be the Golbat using a 30 base power wing attack and Arbok using Acid. That's it. So here we take out the first Gengar, we level up, but now we put the Golbat to sleep, and we're going to use the rest of our minimizes here. And we can just go into Thunderbolt and Psychic. We're outspeeding. It's actually a 2-hit KO on the last Gengar. We get confused, but we don't do too much damage to ourselves. And there we go. Agatha, piece of cake. She just goes down quite easily. Now on to Lance. And in my test run, Lance was one of the hardest because Aerodactyl can basically one-shot us, and if we take a Hyper Beam, we're going to get wrecked. I already know that from my test run before. So we're hoping for a run here where we can put the Gyarados to sleep and get our setup off, and we've learned Blizzard. That's going to be our ace for the rest of the team. So here we put Gyarados to sleep, we're setting up our Minimize, and one Thunderbolt takes it down. One Blizzard for each of the Dragonairs. Now Aerodactyl, one Blizzard, and Dragonite, one Blizzard. There we go. So at this level, Chansey really isn't having that much trouble against the Elite Four. We can see some spots where it's likely to not be perfectly consistent, but it's reasonable. Let's go into the champion. Here the champion Sandslash uses one Earthquake and knocks us out. So we have to win one of five. Let's try a second attempt. Here we take Fury Swipes instead, which is much weaker. We put it to sleep. Now we're setting up our minimize. And really, we can just one-shot the Sandslash at any time with Blizzard, but later that will be important. We take down the Alakazam. Now one Blizzard takes out Exeggutor. Now, we need to use Blizzard here on the Magneton, but we've run out of PP, so we finish it off with Thunderbolt. Two Thunderbolts on Cloyster. And now, on the Flareon, we're just spamming Thunderbolt until we take it down. Well, there we go, folks. We have beaten the entire game when we only need to win one time out of five with a Chansey. And we very nearly swept the entire Elite Four without that one reset on the champion. That would have been a clean sweep of the Elite Four in the champion, but on admittedly very low consistency. So let's reset now and let's try for a 5 out of 5 run and see how this goes. Just keeping in mind that we managed to finish that at level 58. So how many levels higher are we going to be if we have to win 5 of 5? Well, let's get into it. So now, starting our 5 of 5 run, going up even against Rival 1, it's not consistent at level 5, folks. No, we had to level up to level 8 by using rare candies that we game sharked in order to have a decent shot here. And this is not unique to Chansey. A lot of Pokemon would be in the same situation. Really, any Pokemon that has low defense has a chance to just be taken down by this Eevee early on in the game. This is not a layup for a Pokemon like Zubat, for a Pokemon like Pidgey or Rattata. They're going to get taken out a decent percentage of the time here at the very beginning of the game. So the dreams of 5 of 5 consistency basically rip right here in Professor Oak's lab. But if we do allow level ups and see when we can get 5 of 5 and go through the rest of the run, we're going to see that really this is going to be a lot of massive leveling very quickly. Here against the Bug Catcher in Viridian Forest, we basically are just going to take it down at level 8 by using Tail Whip and Pound. This one is pretty consistent right out of the gate. So we're just going to speed up the footage and move on to Brock. So basically going into Brock, we have to remember that with 1 of 5 consistency, we needed to be level 23 to beat Brock, and it clearly wasn't consistent. We're going to start off at level 24 here to see how this goes. At level 24, we do learn Sing, so we have an added advantage here. You might be saying, well, Sing, what's that going to do for you? He uses full heals, right? Well, we have already done the Brock Minimum Battle series on this channel, meaning we know Brock's AI better than anyone, and all we need Brock to do is use Bide. Once he does, we use Sing to put him to sleep, and we can effectively lock him in to Bide for the entire battle. As long as we can keep landing Sing, he will never be able to attack us again. So here in this one, we are using up the rest of our double slaps. Now we're going into Pound. We're going to try to put him back to sleep, but he just released energy, but notice he did no damage. And the reason he did no damage there is because of the fact that in Pokemon Yellow version, Brock will not use full heals while he is using Bide. So if we put him to sleep, he won't use a full heal as long as he's using Bide at the time, meaning that as long as we can keep putting him to sleep, we can effectively infinitely keep him from attacking us. And the turn that he wakes up, it takes a full turn to wake up, so in this version of the game, sleep is completely broken. We can just wreck the entire game with this. But even with that exploit on Brock's AI, it takes a ton of levels to be able to actually beat him 5 of 5. Here we're at level 30 already, trying to take down this Geodude. We're getting better ranges at this point, so we just use a Pound to take it down. Now we're going to go into Tail Whip when we get to Onix initially, but the moment that it uses Bide, we're going to try to go into Sing and hopefully get it locked in that. Here, it uses Bide, but we didn't manage to get the Sing. It uses Bide again, perfect. Now we can use Sing and basically lock it in. And now we are going to spam Pound. And whenever it wakes up, we're going to try to Sing to put it back to sleep. And there we go. We've taken 1 of 5 against Brock, but we've got to do this 5 times. You might be saying, this is getting repetitive. We have to fight 5 times every time. Well, yeah, but if you want to make claims about consistency for a run, you can't do the battle 1 time. We've already shown that we were able to beat this battle 7 levels lower than this when we only needed to win 1 of 5. But the test is 5 of 5 to see if really high consistency is possible at a certain level. So here we're just going to speed through the last few battles after we take this Onix down, and basically, level 30 is looking to be pretty darn consistent. Now, if you're looking for perfect consistency, that's not what we're proving here. We're just proving that you can beat him 5 times in a row. Because if you were going for perfect consistency, we can still see that there's a chance that Onix could just not use Bide and take us out. But 5 of 5 is pretty darn good. That means we've got pretty good odds. We're just going to take it. Now, we are going to skip all of the trainers on the way to Cerulean because none of them are relevant. They're all easy 5 out of 5 victories without any level ups. So let's jump straight to Misty. Misty here could be trouble if she uses the right moves, but we outspeed, we get Sing on Staryu, set up a couple of Tail Whips, and now we can go into Mega Punch to take this one down. Starmie still outspeeds us, it uses a Tackle, that's fine, we're going to use Tail Whip and go into Mega Punch. And really, even with it using Harden and Bubble Beam, Bubble Beam does basically nothing, and we take her down. So we're just going to speed through a bunch of other runs against Misty because it's really not interesting. We're just crushing her every time. Yay, 5 out of 5. We're only, what, 4 levels higher than we were with our 1 out of 5 Chansey, but yay. Now for Rival 2. We already saw that Bubble Beam made his team completely easy. It was a one-shot on the Spearow. It's a one-shot on the Sandshrew and a one-shot on the Rattata and 2 shots on Eevee. But when we did that before, with the chanciest of chanceys, we were doing that 6 levels lower. So, yay, we can do this 6 levels higher. We're just over-leveled at this point. Great. Well, at least it's consistent, right? Right? And nothing else on the way to Bill's house is any challenge at all, so it's straight to the SSN in Rival 3, where this fight is exactly the same as the Rival 2 fight. Come on, 2 hits on the Eevee, that's it. So we have another spot where we're just massively overleveled, but hey, we're able to get through this fight consistently, yay. Let's pick up Cut from the Cut Master and go take on Lieutenant Surge. And here, we are 5 levels higher than we were with the chanciest of chanceys. So we are just hoping that this will be consistent at this point. I hope we don't have to level up to beat him. But 2 Mega Kicks basically would knock us out even at this level. It's a 3-hit KO there. Here we are going to try again where we are definitely using Sing to put him to sleep. And then using Bubble Beam 3 times in a row. There we go, that's 2 of 5. Let's see if we can make it 5 out of 5. We take a massive Mega Kick. We can see that if he hits us 2 turns in a row, we're done. But we take him out the 3rd time. Let's go for the 4th attempt. The fact that he uses X speed when he's already outspeeding is massive. We take a Mega Punch, but it looks like a 3-hit KO with Mega Punch. So very nice. We take him down there. We need 1 more win, and we can move on. Here, we take a massive hit. We're down to 92 HP. We take another hit. We're all the way down to 6 HP, but we finally put him to sleep. And 3 hits, and we win. That's 5 of 5, but we can see it's not perfectly consistent. There's always a chance that he could knock us out there, but fortunately, we're not going for 100% consistency like last week. We're only going for 5 of 5. Let's move on to the Rapping Lass, who presents us with our next massive problem. We're going to learn Thunderbolt because Thunderbolt is stronger than Bubble Beam and try to take these ones down, but it's not a 1-hit KO. And if any of her Pokemon can status us, there's a decent chance that we could lose the fight right there. We get put to sleep by this Bellsprout, and fortunately Rap's not doing too much, but that could present some issues. So let's try fight number 2. Here, we're going to go for Sing. Sing seems to be the best play. They're 2-hit KOs regardless. So if we can just put them to sleep, Poison Powder's not actually that bad because we have tons of HP. What we're really worried about would be paralysis and then getting wrapped down by one of the Bellsprouts. So let's just see. In this one, we are just going into Thunderbolt. We get put to sleep by the Bellsprout. Fortunately, Rap is really weak and we're massively overleveled, otherwise this could be dangerous. And here we are taking down the rest of the team. Okay, that's 3 attempts done. Now let's try attempt number 4. We put the Oddish to sleep, a couple Thunderbolts, very good. Here we are trying to put the Bellsprout to sleep. It's using Growth, that's another issue. We get Paralysis on it though, so that's nice. 3-hit KO and it goes down. Now we get Paralyzed. And we are taking Rap from this Bellsprout. And It's a 3-hit KO because of all of its growths, but we finally take it out. There we go. Let's try one more attempt. And here, we are just going to use basically the same strategy. We're going for Thunderbolt. We take Poison. Poison's really the best status that we could take, so we'll just stick with it. And Poison is good because it keeps us from being put to sleep or paralyzed, basically. So now we are just going to sit here and take out the rest of our team. And nothing else on that route matters, so let's go ahead and just get straight to Rival 4, where this is a completely trivial fight. We one-shot Firo. It's going to take a couple of hits here on the Magnemite, just because we don't have a super effective move, but then we're going to one-shot the Shellder as soon as we're not confused. We're going to one-shot Sandshrew, and it's 2 hits on the Eevee. Done and done. So let's just speed through the rest of these, because this is a complete waste of time just repeating the battle over and over again. But here at the end of this battle, we're seeing something very important. We level up to level 38, and now we're getting minimized. So we're over-leveled, but we've got access to a better move. We pick up Ice Beam, and let's go straight to Erica. Now, Erica's super easy. We just set up a couple of minimize, and then it's 2 hits on Tangela, and we actually managed to one-shot both Weepinbell and Gloom because we're just so massively over-leveled. So we can repeat this a bunch of times. I'm just going to speed up the footage because it's not terribly interesting. And once we get through Erica, we can just make our way to the Rocky Game Corner. Nothing there is a challenge. Let's just make our way to Giovanni, where Ice Beam just wrecks everything. Perfect. Done. And this is basically what consistency runs always just devolve into, is a one-shot fest. Because, oh, it's consistent if you just one-hit or two-hit KO all your opponents, but is that really interesting? Here, top of Pokemon Tower. It's going to be another one-shot fest. Hey. Let's just one-shot Meowth, one-shot Arbok, one-shot... it was 2 shots on Weezing. So let's do it again, even though it's obvious that this is pretty consistent. But, you know, for the sake of being consistent, right? Well, here in this one, we get paralyzed by the Arbok, we get bad paralysis luck, and we get taken out by Sludge. So clearly, oh yeah, we need to level up more, or we need to change our moveset because it wasn't consistent enough, right? If you're not one-shotting everything every time, it's not going to be consistent enough, right? So here, we're just going to change our moveset. Basically, the rules are we either have to change our moveset or we have to level up. We're just going to go ahead and learn Psychic. And what move can we learn Psychic over? I decide to learn it over Thunderbolt. We can pick up Thunder later, that'll be just fine for Lorelei. So here, Psychic. Guess what? Psychic will guarantee one-shots on all these Pokemon, so it will be perfectly consistent except for the chances of a Gen 1 miss. Great! I'm so excited when I do this. This is the most skillful way to play Pokemon, clearly. So once we get through our massive one-shot fest, we can save Mr. Fuji, get the Pokeflute, and move on with our journey, where, just keep in mind, we've already beaten the entire game at a much lower level than this, but let's go ahead and fight Koga, because Koga is going to be the easiest fight here. We already know that Rival 5 might be difficult. Here against Koga, we put him to sleep. We're going to go ahead and use Minimize, but hey, in this one, we actually have access to Psychic. And Psychic is super effective against all of these Pokemon, so I'm not sure even that all this setup is necessary. We're one-shotting all of the Venonats, and here it looks like it's a 3-hit KO might be a range on the Venomoth. Let's try this a few more times. And really, the advantage that we have here is that we have a massive special stat, so Psychic, Psybeam, their strongest attacks really just don't do anything to us. We'd only really be worried about Double Edge from the third Venonat, but we're one-shotting it. So as long as we don't get terrible double team luck on the Venomoth, we're probably getting through this fight no problem. So we can repeat it a bunch of times just to make sure, but I'm really not too worried about this fight. So here we're all the way to Venomoth. We are getting pretty low on HP though, but we take it down. And let's try one more for good measure. Here, Sing. Minimize, 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 psychic, psychic,
Psychic. Oh, it wasn't a one-hit KO on the third Venonat. Oh, no. And it's two hits on the Venomoth. So there we go. We've beaten Koga. Great. We could have done that like six levels lower, but that's fine. Let's go fight Rival 5 now and see if this one is consistent. So here against Rival 5, the strategy is going to be basically the same. We need to put the first Sandslash to sleep. We need to set up our Minimize. Then we need to go into spamming Ice Beam, or in this case, Psychic, because we don't have Thunderbolt for Cloyster. But Ice Beam should one-shot the Sandslash regardless. So as long as we get our setup done, there we go, we take it down. We have a chance to learn Defense Curl, we're just going to skip it again. Psychic is perfectly fine on Cloyster, it doesn't have great special relative to its other stats. And we are able to whittle our way through the rest of his team without too much difficulty here. So there we go. So let's just speed up some footage and take attempt number 2 that goes clearly well. Attempt number 3 is clearly going the same. Attempt number 4, hey, this isn't too bad. And now let's come back for attempt number 5. Let's just finish this off. And we're going to set up Sing. Okay, perfect. Minimize. We try to use Sing again. It misses. And we take a pretty big Swift and a Slash, and now we've lost on the 5th attempt. Oh no. We have to level up because that's the only way that we're allowed to get through this fight. We can't go get Substitute. Substitute is banned, folks. And I hear people saying, well, clearly this was consistent. You don't need to level up here. But you have to have a consistent rule set in order to make consistent runs. If you break your own rules and say, oh, it's okay to get lucky before the Elite Four, as long as we don't get lucky on the Elite Four, for example, you're no longer consistent. So here, finally, we are able to get through the rival with 5 of 5. So now we can move on to Giovanni. Team Rocket doesn't matter. They're all just one-hit KOs. So here, Giovanni, we have Psychic. So we can one-shot the Nidorino. And we're outspeeding because we're already massively overleveled. Psychic is perfectly fine for his whole team, basically. We get through on the first attempt. Okay. Well, let's try this again. So we one-shot the Nidorino. Here, I try Sing and Minimize on the Persian just to see. Maybe it will make it even more consistent. We take that one down. Ice Beam for the Rhyhorn, and we get taken out. So instead, let's go try fighting Blaine. We don't need to level up. We don't need to change our moveset. Let's just try Blaine. Let's see how this goes. And on Blaine, basically, we're trying to take advantage of the fact that outside of Stomp and Takedown, none of his other moves should really do that much to us. We get our setup off, we're able to take down the Ninetales, but we take a massive stomp and a takedown and we get taken out by Rapidash. Okay, well now we just have to level up because we've been beaten by Blaine, we've been beaten by Giovanni. Let's go back at a higher level and try Giovanni again. Here in this one, we are just going to try to use Sing and set up our Minimize here on the Rhyhorn. Rhyhorn doesn't have that many strong moves that it can use, it's basically just using Horn Attack. So it's probably our best shot to set up. All the other Pokemon know like Double Kick or Persian knows Slash, so this is probably the best strategy. So we can repeat this a bunch of times over and over and over again because, hey, we've got to get 5 out of 5, right? We can see we beat him a bunch of times, but let's come back in this one. Let's just see. Here, I'm actually going for Sing on Nidorino, which is probably not the best strategy, but we take out all of their Pokemon. We're getting on very low health, though. We Sing on the Rhyhorn, and we're going to set up Minimize here, take it down, and we miss on the Nidoqueen, and we get a double kick. So we have to level up again, because hey, them's the rules. We have to win 5 out of 5. If we don't win 5 out of 5, we have to change our moveset or level up. So now we're a whole level higher. Let's see if we can get through now. In the end, we don't just have to add one level in order to get through this. We actually end up losing yet again in this fight. So we have to level up yet again to level 47 before we are able to get 5 in a row where we actually beat Giovanni and are able to move on. This is the problem with high levels of consistency. We're winning 3 of 5, 4 of 5. We're just not winning 5 of 5. And if we put an arbitrary number like that, well,
we're going to end up massively overleveled. Let's go back to Blaine. Let's see how this goes against him now. We're at a higher level. We're all the way at level 48 at this point. So we are actually matching the Ninetales in level. This never happens in my runs. I'm usually overleveled, and we get taken out the first attempt. And really, there's not much else to try. We can go fight Sabrina at this point, but that's pretty much it. So I decided to add one level here. Let's just see if we can get through at level 49. We're going to have to get through Blaine eventually, no matter what. And I'm expecting Giovanni to be an absolute nightmare when we fight him in his gym. So here, level 49, we're able to get through the Ninetales. We're able to get through the Rapidash. And we are able to get through Arcanine. Great. We just have to repeat it 4 more times. Let's see if this is going to happen. Well, here, we're going to try to set up Minimize here on the Ninetales. It's not even really worth going for Sing. Sing is so inaccurate, 55% accuracy, that it kind of is a waste of time at this point. If we can survive a couple hits, we may as well just go for Minimize. So there we've got 2 out of 2. Let's try for 3. 3 in a row. Can we go? 3 in a row. Well, we're taking some massive hits, and we're all the way down to 129 HP, but let's see if Psychic will get us through. Perfect, we get through the Ninetales, and we're using some Ice Beams on Rapidash, nice, and we take a Fire Blast and we get knocked out. Great. So at this point, we're just going to start adding levels and see if we can manage to get through. We're all the way at level 51, still failing, so let's go fight Sabrina. And Sabrina is pretty tough. 4 5 out of 5 because she uses accuracy strats right off the bat with her Abra. By lowering our accuracy, it doesn't make it so that this is an impossible fight. We can easily win 3 out of 5, 4 out of 5. We're just not going to win 5 out of 5 because there's the chance that we'll use up all of our PP and just miss with everything. Here we can see we're getting tons of misses, and Kadabra and Alakazam both know Recover. And you could say, well, what about Sing? Well, Sing is not very accurate, even as I'm landing a few Sings trying to use up my PP. And the fact that these Pokemon know Recover means Struggle is not a good strategy here, because we'll just end up struggling ourselves to death in this battle. So even here at level 51, this is not that consistent. Even though we were able to do it on 1 of 5 very easily at a much lower level. So the question is, how much are we going to have to overlevel in order to make these 5 of 5 runs work? And yeah, it's just time to start adding in more and more rare candies. Let's here at level 59, we're still running out of PP on the Alakazam pretty regularly. And we've got full health. We could struggle it down if we can just keep it asleep. But really, it uses Recover. And now it's back to full HP. And unless we can land a bunch of struggles in a row and not have it use Recover, because the AI doesn't have PP on its moves, it can just use them infinitely in Gen 1, we're basically going to lose this fight. And it's just death by 1,000 paper cuts. We've won this battle plenty of times in the lead up to this. We could have just moved on without any need to level up. But hey, if we make the rule set that you have to win 5 out of 5 to be consistent, just doesn't work. It's back to Blaine. What level are we going to be able to beat Blaine at? We're already at a much higher level. We're at level 59, so clearly we just overleveled against Sabrina. This is going to be consistent. We're just going to crush him. Well, no, we lose the first attempt. And at this point, we've just got to start leveling up again until we find the level that it's actually possible at. So fortunately, it's only one more level, level 60, that we're finally able to get a bunch of runs where we win in a row. Now we can go into the last run. This is attempt number 5, and we're setting up our Minimize. We're going to go into Ice Beam. We freeze the Ninetales. Great. Now let's use Ice Beam on Rapidash. It's 2-hit KO. And we're going to try to put the Arcanine to sleep and then spam some Ice Beams. Finally, we have gotten through Blaine. That gets us a badge boost now in our special, so we can go back and take on Sabrina. And what level will Sabrina actually be consistent at? Well, fortunately, the badge boost is huge here, because a badge boost in special means that we're doing more damage to her and she's doing less damage to us. So finally, here at level 60, with badge boosts, we are able to finally make our way through the Alakazam, and we are able to call this a win with 5 wins against Sabrina in a row. But all that leveling means nothing when we get to Giovanni, because even here on the first attempt, we're just going to take out the Doug Trio immediately. We're going to try to set up on the Persian, but both of these Nidos can one-shot us. And okay, Rhydon goes down to Psychic, that's perfectly fine. But here's the issue when it comes to Giovanni. One Earthquake takes us out. So now we have to just start leveling up massively, and we're already at a higher level than we beat the entire game with the chanciest of chances. When it was only 1 in 5, we beat the game at level 58, and we're already going in the high 60s, basically getting up to level 70 in order to get 5 in a row. It's no problem to win 3 out of 5 or even 4 out of 5 at this point, but 5 out of 5 is elusive because we still don't outspeed the Dugtrio or the Persian, and both of those Pokemon can get a critical hit and knock us out, and they have high crit chances. So really, now we have to make rules where, oh, well, if we take a critical hit and we lose, then we don't have to repeat the battle, but then Persian Slash is always going to be a critical hit, so when do we bend our rules now? It just has to be consistent, guys. You can't make consistent runs and have inconsistent rules. So finally, at level 76, we beat Giovanni. But this is ridiculous. We're already 18 levels overleveled compared to what we need to beat the champion at this point. Okay. So now Rival 6 is not really a problem. We're able to set up, we put the Cloyster to sleep, we're setting up our Minimize here because we can just one-shot the Sandslash and the Execute. We take it down, now we're using Psychic to take down Magneton, we freeze Kadabra, great, and now a couple Psychics takes out the Flareon. And this one is incredibly consistent at this point. We don't need to do any more leveling up, grinding. The strategy is perfectly fine. We could probably still find a run where we eventually lose because nothing is going to be 100% consistent, but it's 5 out of 5. So now moving on to Lorelei. We are going to be adding Thunder to our moveset. I know Thunder is only 70% accurate, but we really only need it for this one fight. We had to forget Thunderbolt or Ice Beam earlier because of the fact that we needed to learn Psychic. And we really don't want to forget Psychic before Bruno and Agatha. So here, we are going to go ahead and try to set up Sing on the Dewgong and set up some of our Minimize here. And we're at a higher level, so we actually don't have to worry about leveling up mid-battle. So we can keep our badge boosts all the way till the end. We take out Cloyster, take out Slowbro. We're going to keep using Thunder here on the Jinx, one-hit KO. It's a one-hit KO on Lapras. Everything is a one-hit KO. Great. So let's speed through this and get to Bruno. And, I mean, Lorelei is really just not any trouble in this section. Like, we might be thinking that it's a little bit luck-based, but not really. Because Minimize plus Sing gives us so many tools. So now we're at Bruno, and we just have to heal up real quick and get into this fight, where we're going for 5 of 5 here. But I think we've already got the strategy, because Psychic is perfectly fine for all of his Pokemon. We're just going to put the first Onix to sleep, use a few Minimize. And with all our badge boosts in place, this is going to be a one-shot fest of Psychic over and over and over again, because none of these Pokemon can resist it. So we're just going to repeat this a few times, and really all we would be worried about would be taking a lucky high jump kick from the Hitmonlee or a submission from Machamp, but when they're all one-hit KOs, that's basically never going to happen unless we Gen 1 miss. So let's move on to Agatha now, where, again, the play is going to be Psychic this whole battle. So all we want to do is start by hopefully taking out the first Gengar, and we actually get a switch to the Golbat, but we can see that without any setup of Minimize, we're just wrecking this fight because these Pokemon can't really do anything to us. So there we go, folks. We've achieved a completely consistent run against Agatha, but it's all based on the fact that we just one-shot or two-shot all of her Pokemon. Great. So now let's move on to Lance. Lance could present a problem, because if he hits us with a Hyper Beam with his Gyarados, we're probably getting taken out. And if he hits us with a Hyper Beam from his Aerodactyl, I think we're definitely getting taken out. So here, we're going to use Sing on Gyarados. We're going to set up our Minimize right here, because Thunder's not perfectly accurate. Now, with Badge Boosts, we were able to survive a Hyper Beam. Keep in mind, we have Badge Boosts in defense. So here, we take down the Dragonairs. Now, we managed to finally hit a Thunder on Aerodactyl. And I'm just using Thunder here in this first one, and we managed to get through. That's right, folks. Even making a mistake and forgetting to teach Blizzard, this was completely consistent, but we add Blizzard the next battle, and we're just crushing his entire team with no difficulty, no need to level up, no need to do anything, because Blizzard just one-shots everything. Great. So now we can move on to the champion. We are already at level 80. We are 23 levels higher than we were with the Chanseyest of Chanseys. And this Chansey is basically a no Chansey. I think we have to get perfect consistency here. So we one-shot Sandslash. We're going to do all of our setup on Alakazam. Sandslash has moves that could actually knock us out, like Slash and Earthquake, whereas Alakazam is going to use Psychic and Psybeam, Recover, might lower our accuracy with Kinesis, but that would be the worst case. We take it down, we're all the way to Cloyster. It's a one-shot with Thunder, and a one-shot with Thunder on the Flareon, because we have massive badge boosts. So let's try this again. We are going to one-shot the Sandslash. We're going to set up Sing here on Alakazam, just because we don't want to take a bunch of accuracy drops or special drops. And here, we're just going to try to keep it asleep while we set up our Minimize. And then after everything's set up, hey, Thunder. And this becomes a nice little one-shot fest, folks. Great. This is so skillful. I'm so proud of how skillful I am at the game that I can figure out how to level up enough to one-shot everything. This is just brilliant. This is what I always wanted to do when I made this channel. So, anyway, we're going to do attempt number 3, where it's a repeat of the exact same thing. Set up Sing, set up our Minimize, and then we're just going to start taking this one down. And yeah, we can miss, but we have Minimize, so we're perfectly fine. And this is basically a perfectly consistent fight, outside of a Blizzard miss on the Sandslash. That could be bad. Or getting bad ranges against everything else. And because we don't level up because we're so massively overleveled, well, now we don't have to worry about losing our badge boosts in the middle of the fight. And we can say that this one is probably pretty close to perfectly consistent, about as consistent as you could ever get a fight with the luck that exists in the game. So let's take one last attempt here. We just need to make it 5-5, and then we can pat ourselves on the back, because we had a consistent run that had no challenge in it whatsoever, because every time we ran into a challenge, we just leveled up. And if you get to a high enough level where you just one shot and two shot everything, you can just hand the Game Boy over to your kids, over to your friend who's never played Pokemon before, and just tell them, hey, hit the A button. And, oh yeah, look, you just beat the game. Congratulations. Yay. Yeah, that's how I feel doing this. So when we do actual consistency content in the future, we've already figured out a couple things, as I clearly can't count and I'm fighting a sixth battle against the champion just to make sure that it's completely consistent. When we go do our own consistency runs in the future, we're clearly not going to go 5-5. It's a waste of time, and it doesn't really do anything strategically. It's just, okay, what level do we one-shot everything? So let's come back and try one last run where we're going to do this on a more reasonable level of consistency. 3 of 5. Because we saw a lot of tough fights there that 3 of 5 was working, even though 1 of 5 wasn't. So let's get into this. Starting off with Brock, when can we beat him 3 of 5? Level 24. This is one level higher than the chanciest of chanceys, and 6 levels lower than the no chancy. So, in our reasonable chancy, we are able to get through this really just with one additional level. And that's going to hold up for a lot of the game. We're just going to use the same strategy where when he uses Bide, we use Sing, and now we can go into using our double slaps and just whittle this one down. Really no problem at all. It's reasonably consistent at level 24. And sure, 5 of 5 doesn't work here, but 3 of 5 is no problem whatsoever. So we're just going to whittle him down little by little. And once we get through this fight, I'm basically just going to cut ahead, folks, because this video is already way too long and we don't really need to see every single battle. Misty is already completely consistent at level 26. We didn't need all the extra levels. We can go down to Lieutenant Surge, who, again, level 31 is all that we needed. We're 4 levels lower than the no luck Chansey. Against Erica, we're at level 35. This is the same level that our 5 of 5 run was beating Lieutenant Surge, and we're beating Erica with no real troubles. Basically, Sing plus Ice Beam is enough. The first place where we actually struggle is Koga. And the reason we struggle against Koga is because of Toxic. Toxic can actually take us out a lot of times. Basically, when we take Toxic early in the fight, that can result in us getting knocked out because we just run out of HP by the time we are able to take his Pokemon down. All of his Pokemon are 2-hit KOs, maybe 3-hit KOs, unless we learn Psychic. And this time I decided to learn Psychic and actually put it over Ice Beam. I decided to keep Thunderbolt instead. This was actually played before the 5 out of 5 run, so that was a mistake on my part. I should have just kept Ice Beam. Ice Beam has a chance to freeze. Freeze is much more useful than the chance to paralyze. Anyway, here with Psychic, we can basically start one-shotting the first 2 Venonats. It's 2 shots on the 3rd Venonat, but then it's only going to be 3 hits on the Venomoth. So even with Toxic, we get through no problem. And now we can move on to Rival 5. Against Rival 5, it's just not quite consistent enough at level 41, so we do end up having to pop one Rare Candy here, because basically he can lower our accuracy, and because I didn't have Ice Beam, we couldn't just take out the Sandslash quickly and get to the rest of his team. Like I said, mistake on my part, probably added one level that we didn't need to get here in this run, but that's okay because Giovanni's coming up. We know he's going to be a massive troll to us, so this one level probably doesn't matter that much. Here, we are going to go ahead and get one extra level, get to level 42. At this point, we set up Sleep, we set up Minimize, and once we can get all of our setup done, Psychic is a 2-hit KO on the Sandslash, it's 1 Thunderbolt on Cloyster, it's going to be a couple of Psychics here on the Magneton, Thunderbolt to take down the Kadabra, and basically we just have to use 3 or 4 Thunderbolts now to take out the Flareon, but pretty consistent. Now going into Giovanni, Psychic is enough to get through this without any level ups. We one-shot the Nidorino, it's going to be 2 shots to take down the Persian with Thunderbolt. Here we're going to set up our Sing and our Minimize on Rhyhorn because this is absolutely the best play, with it just being able to use Horn Attack, and a couple of Psychics takes out the Nidoqueen. Done. So let's just see it repeated a few more times just to make sure it's actually consistent. We've won 2 out of 2. We've won 3 out of 3. There we go. Now let's move on to Sabrina. Sabrina was another spot where we really struggled when we tried to go for high consistency because of the Abra spamming Flash.
basically accuracy drops were the only reason that we were struggling with this. Because we can tank all of her special attacks, and as long as they don't use recover a bunch of times, we can knock these Pokemon out in a reasonable number of turns. So here, at level 45, we are getting through this just fine. We're 15 levels lower than our 0 luck, 5 out of 5 Chansey. And yeah, we're just crushing this one. As long as we can keep Alakazam asleep long enough to deal damage, and we can use Psychic here to try to lower its special stat, and it's just a matter of accuracy luck. That's it. So as long as we get decent accuracy luck, we're just going to whittle this one down, and there we go. We're on our last Thunderbolt, but we took it out. We're going to speed up the footage here just so that we can show that we actually beat her 3 out of 5 times, because hey, for these tough battles, it kind of makes sense to show that we actually were able to do it. Here in this one, we paralyzed the Alakazam, but we ran out of PP, so we just reset. And here, finally, we get a run where last battle, we're all the way to Alakazam, is asleep. We're just spamming Psychic and Thunderbolt. Wakes up, we put it back to sleep, and there we go. 3 out of 5 is not hard to do, and we're not having to get 15 levels over leveled to beat this opponent. Just relative to 3 out of 5, 5 out of 5 required 15 additional levels. Just think about that for a second. So now we can make our way to Blaine and try him. Now, Blaine is a battle that we absolutely can beat at this level. Level 46, we just put the Ninetales to sleep. We're going to set up our Minimize, and once we get our Minimize set up, we're going to be able to go into Thunderbolt and Psychic in order to try to take these Pokemon down. We're trying to keep him asleep just because I think that will raise our chances of getting through. But here, Rapidash takes just 4 hits to take down. Now Arcanine, I really want to put it to sleep. Takedown did massive damage there. And that's with all of our badge boosts set up. But we get through. So, hey, that's nice. The problem is this. We kept getting runs like this one where I would get burned by the Ninetales, and it takes so many turns to get through that between confusion and burns, this just wasn't 3 of 5. We were getting 2 of 5, but not 3 of 5. So we have to level up. That's the rules. We can't go get substitute. That's a banned TM, remember? And basically, there's nothing else we'd really want to add to our moveset anyway. But here, one level higher, we are getting the luck where we are able to put this opponent to sleep. And really, as long as we don't get burned, we're fine. We could have just said, well, we don't need to level up. We just need to not get a 1 in 10 chance of getting burned. But you have to be consistent. If you're saying you got to win 3 of 5, then you got to win 3 of 5. So now moving on to Rapidash, it's just a matter of taking out with Psychic. And we're going to spam some Psychics. We got a special drop. Perfect. And we take down the Arcanine. So there we go. We've beaten Blaine 12 levels lower than when we were trying to go for 5 of 5 consistency, even though we're higher level than we were with the 1 in 5 super lucky Chansey. Doesn't really matter. Now Giovanni presents the next big struggle because we can see that his Pokemon can just one-shot us or two-shot us very, very easily, and we're outsped by the Dugtrio. So this is one where we're going to have to level up again. Giovanni is really one of the toughest battles in the game in Pokemon Yellow. Very different from Pokemon Red and Blue, because in Red and Blue, he wouldn't know Earthquake with any of his Pokemon. He wouldn't know Fissure with his Dugtrio. He wouldn't know Double Kick with the Nidos. He doesn't have a Persian that has a 100% chance to critical hit with Slash. So in this one, we've just got to keep leveling up to see what level this is actually going to be consistent at. Keep in mind that for 5 out of 5, we had to get all the way up to level 78 in order to beat this fight. 78 in order to make 5 out of 5 in a row. Yet winning 1 out of 5 only required us to be at level 48 at the end of the fight. 47 going in, 48 at the end. How about this one?
What level are we going to finish this one at? Is it going to be closer to the no luck Chansey or the lucky Chansey? Let's find out. We're at level 57 right now. Now we're at level 58. And if you want to watch all these battles in their entirety, you can just slow down the footage on YouTube. But here at level 58, we are finally getting consistent enough that we can start off by putting the Dugtrio to sleep. It's our best shot to set up. Dugtrio can use Fissure, which is only 30% accurate, and it can use Sand Attack, which can miss. And we take it down. Now Thunderbolt on the Persian, a couple Psychics on the Nidos, and a Psychic on the Rhydon. We're through. So we were only 10 levels higher than the lucky Chansey, but 20 levels lower than the 5 out of 5 no luck Chansey. Now at our current level, Rival 6 can be a little bit of a challenge, because first off, we didn't keep Ice Beam. If we had kept Ice Beam again, that was just a strategy mistake on my part. Ice Beam, we'd just be one-shotting the Sand Slash and the Execute and setting up on the Cloister. That's clearly the best strategy. I did the 5 out of 5 run last, so that I would actually know the most about the strategy and give it the best chance to perform. And even with all the knowledge that I had gathered, everything that I had learned from the first two runs, plus my test run, it still struggled that much. Here, we don't need to gain any additional levels. We can get unlucky and lose against the Sand Slash, but basically once we get through the Sand Slash, the rest of the team is completely easy here at level 59, keeping in mind that we just leveled up in the Giovanni fight. So here a couple Thunderbolts takes out Execute, a Thunderbolt takes out the Cloister, a couple Psychics for Magneton, a couple Thunderbolts for Kadabra, and it's going to be three Psychics to take down the Flareon. Yeah, this one is not really that bad. So we just need to win one more time in order to show that it is 3 out of 5. We take a big hit from the Sand Slash, but we keep putting it back to sleep, minimize. And yeah, really, if I had just been smart enough to keep Ice Beam, we'd be doing just fine here. But I thought Thunderbolt for Lorelei would be more important than Ice Beam. And yeah, it isn't. You need Ice Beam here. Here, we just go ahead and run through the rivals team one more time. And there we go. 3 out of 5. Not hard. Now we can move on to the Elite Four, where we already know our strategy here against Lorelei. We're going to use Thunderbolt. So we just need to use some badge boosts here. And basically, we just want her to go to sleep either via rest or sting. So I decided to attack her immediately and just let her go ahead and use rest. Once we get our minimizes set up, we go into a one-shot fest with Thunderbolt till we level up right here on the Jinx. That's still fine. Takes 3 hits to take it down, and it's going to take a few hits to take down the Lapras, but really not bad. So we'll just run through the rest of her fights, which really are pretty uneventful because we just crush here. We can move on to Bruno, and Bruno is another complete pushover. I mean, we've got Psychic, so he's not going to do that much to us. Now, we can lose the fight. He can get a lucky submission on us, but it's just not that likely once we've got all our minimized set up and we're using sleep tactics and we've got Psychic, which is super effective. So the strategy is just to put the first Onix to sleep, set up our minimize, because we really just are trying to avoid a hit. And then we can go into Thunderbolt here, Psychic, and we're going to put the Machamp to sleep just to make this really consistent, and Psychic, we got a critical hit that time and took it down. So Bruno is just a complete pushover, and now we can move on to Agatha, who is really more of the same. Anytime you've got Earthquake, Dig, or Psychic on a Pokemon with decent stats, you're going to crush Agatha. She's not actually that hard. And so in this one, it's just a matter of set up some minimize and go into spamming Psychic to take out all of her Pokemon. And they really just can't stand up to us. We've got 6 badge boosts in special. It's a 2-hit KO on the last Gengar. But now we can move on to Lance. And Lance could be difficult. We'll just have to find out. So we're just going to lead off by teaching ourselves Blizzard, since Blizzard will be super effective against basically everything on his team.
and we'll keep Thunderbolt to take down the Gyarados. So here, we're just going to put the Gyarados to sleep, set up our Minimize, and really, as long as we don't take a Hyper Beam or take a critical hit fly from this Aerodactyl, we're probably fine. Here, we get all the way to the end. We take one hit from Dragonite, doesn't matter. We knock it out. So here we are. We are all the way to the champion. We are at a much lower level than we were when we were trying to go 5 out of 5. And really, it's just a question of, okay, are we going to be able to take him down? Now, the champion is not particularly easy. And here at level 64, we're going to see that even when we're trying to get Sing set up, we take decent damage from his attacks. We can get knocked out. It wasn't quite 5 of 5. We were actually achieving about 2 of 5 on that at level 64. So really, what can we do? Do we need to change our moveset? Well, I decide, you know what? Let's just add one level with a rare candy. Let's see if level 65 is enough. Remember, we need to win 3 out of 5 attempts here. So this one's going fairly well so far. We're setting up our Minimize, and once we get Minimize set up, we can go into Blizzard. I accidentally misclicked and chose Thunderbolt, but here we're able to take down Alakazam. We are going to try to Sing on Exeggutor, which again was a mistake. Blizzard is just the way to go. It actually took a few turns to take out Magneton because I was using Thunderbolt, just not paying enough attention. But here, even with Leech Seed, we're doing okay in this one, but Leech Seed plus Fire Spin is pretty strong. We still get through. So let's try it. Attempt number 2. We got to get 3 of 5. So here on attempt number 2, we are setting up Sing. We are going for Minimize, and as long as we can keep Sandslash asleep, we'll be just fine. And like we said in the 5 out of 5 run, really the best strategy would have just been to use Blizzard and take out the Sandslash as quickly as possible. But this is working. We take out Alakazam. Here, we get put to sleep by the Exeggutor. And it's because at a lower level like this, Exeggutor is not a guaranteed one-hit KO. So we take it down though. Now we use Sing on Magneton. We use a Blizzard and take it down. Thunderbolt takes out Cloyster. And here I decided, hey, let's go for Sing on Flareon and then try to take it down that way. Perfect. We're 2 out of 2. So we just got to win one more. And then this is a victory. So here we put the Sandslash to sleep. We're setting up our Minimize. This is looking pretty good so far. As long as we keep it asleep and we get all our Minimize set up, there we go. Blizzard one-shots it. Here we use Thunderbolt. We use Blizzard on Exeggutor. Okay, let's put this Magneton to sleep. There it goes. Thunderbolt. And hey, let's go ahead and take down the Flareon as well. And here we're going to achieve our 3 out of 5. So level 66, 15 levels lower. So we can just call it a victory right there. And that is the end of the run. So what can we take away from this? This massively long video that I'm about to upload to YouTube. Well, two things. High levels of consistency are not necessarily desirable, because being highly consistent generally just means being over-leveled and being able to one-shot or two-shot all of your opponents. I don't personally understand why that's interesting. There's no skill in that. There's no challenge in that. It's just, hey, mash the A button until you win. Adding in things like Minimize or Sleep Tactics at least make the game more interesting, because there's a chance that you could still be knocked out. There's a chance that your opponent could wake up. There's a chance that your move will miss. That actually makes these runs interesting to me personally. So 5 out of 5 is something that we're never really going to do on this channel. Sorry for anybody who really wants that. Go watch somebody else. What we will do, however, is for the sake of consistency, we'll look at perhaps 3 out of 5, just to say that, hey, we're able to repeat the same luck multiple times. Or really, my gut instinct is the 1 out of 5. Because with 5 attempts, you're basically saying, okay, within a reasonable number of attempts, can you make it happen? In a lot of these minimum battles runs, that is the case. You can make the run happen on a reasonable number of attempts. But defining what reasonable is a matter of preference, a matter of opinion. But if we have to repeat every single battle 5 times for the entire game, with 65 required battles in the game, that means that at the very least, we're going to be playing 325 battles for every single run, which is a little ridiculous for me in terms of my time, for you guys in terms of actually showing it in videos. It just doesn't make much sense. So really, I'm between 1 of 5 or 3 of 5 for my level of consistency when I do runs. But tell me what you think in the comments down below. Anyway, I hope you liked it. Like, subscribe. See you in the next video. Later.